Everyone and welcome to my channel. My name is Farida and today we have a very special guest on the show. Her name is Zulaika Nase and she's one of Malaysia's top female golfers who is currently on a full golf scholarship at an American university. Zulaika started playing golf at the tender age of 7 and within 3 years she was invited to play in the US Kids Golf World Championship European Tour in Scotland where she was the only Malaysian in her category. In 2014, at the age of 12, she won her first under-12 division in an international tournament when at the MBank International Championship against the top 3 junior Thai players. In 2018, Zulaika competed in 2 competitions in the United States, the Future Champions Junior Golf and the IMG Academy Junior World Championships. It was there that she was scouted by Sam Houston State University, which subsequently offered her a full golf scholarship. She is currently in her sophomore year there. Zulaika is also very special to me because she happens to be my niece. And I've seen her grow up from a little child to become a confident, occasionally crazy, funny and intelligent young woman. Welcome to the show, Zulaika.
Thank you.
So tell us what's going on with your life right now.
Right now, I'm back in the States to continue my studies at Sam Houston. It's my sophomore year, so I'm really excited to go back because I have a lot of things in plan because of the COVID. I couldn't do much. I couldn't play a lot of tournaments, but we should be back on track this semester.
So you came back to Malaysia a couple of months ago when
yes.
COVID hit. Could you tell us when you came back and what it's been like studying online mm-hmm. since you've been back?
I came back in March, mid-March.
Of last year, right?
Of last year, of 2020. To me, it was a little tough because I like human interaction. I like face-to-face interaction. I would rather be in class with a teacher. But online, for a person who is really far away from university, I feel that they have done their best. And I think that I have done my best as well to try to cope with golf. The time zones and also keeping up with my grades.
Wonderful. So you're studying mass communication at Sam Houston State University. What made you decide to choose mass communication?
I chose mass communication because I feel that mass communication is a very broad subject. I'm taking multi-platform journalism, which means I get to pick, I get to experience every single bit of anything that's in mass communication, such as broadcasting, journalism, film, and so much more. So I feel that that leaves the door wide open for me to really figure out what I want to do in life when I graduate and get the degree. So yeah.
So you've been playing golf for a long time now, almost 10 years. So take us back to when you started. What made you decide to start playing golf?
So I started playing golf. My parents both don't play golf, but my cousins do on my mom's side. So I grew up watching them play, but I never really said, "Mommy, I really want to play golf." No. But I went for my cousin's birthday party and they had golf games, you know, where my uncle would say, "Okay, kids, let's go try hit a ball." So somehow, I think with me growing up with cousins that played golf, I knew how it looked like. I knew how a swing was supposed to be. So somehow I'm very good at mimicking. So I somehow mimicked how to swing the golf club. So I guess my uncle thought, you know, she might have a thing for golf, so why not give it a try?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's the beginning of how you started. Mm-hmm. Now, we hear a lot of stories about young people who started their careers, whether it's music or art or sports, very early in life. Mm-hmm. And so you started playing at the age of 7 and you started competing quite early as well. So do you feel like you missed out on anything in your childhood?
Definitely, I feel like I missed out on, I wouldn't say a lot, but things that were not as important for me as a sportswoman, but for like teenagers or people who are growing up. I didn't get to go out a lot with my friends. Every time they would say, you know, let's hang out, I would have something on, I would have a tournament, or I just couldn't because I was practicing. And somehow it was a bit difficult because they never really understood why I couldn't. They would just think, you know, she just doesn't want to hang out with us, which made me feel sad because they never really understood the sacrifices that I took. But I missed out a lot on those type of things. But other than that, I think it was a good choice for me to sacrifice for me to play golf.
So Zulaika, you were the youngest player to play in the LPGA in Malaysia in October 2017, mm-hmm. when you were just 15 years old. In fact, you had just turned 15 at that time. Now, you told me that you got to play with your idol, the former Taiwanese number one, Yani Seng, in that tournament for 2 days. Mm-hmm. Tell us what that was like.
I was definitely shocked. I never thought in my life, from having a poster of her in my room and looking up to her every single day, that I would have dreamt to play with her or even have the opportunity to speak to her. But there's so many things that she gave me advice on, but I don't think I can single out on one. But what I can say is that she's such a down-to-earth person, and she told me that whatever it is, how high you make it in the industry or whatever, always be humble, you know, and know where you come from. And she said that, you know, not everybody makes it for the rest of their life. When they're number one, they're never going to stay number one. There's always a time that you are going to lose. There's always a time that you're always going to fail. But that doesn't mean you should give up. That's what she told me. Because she was world number one for a long time, but she dropped after a while.
How long was she world number one?
I would say a solid 2 to 3 years.
Wow.
She was one of the best. And she's always been really nice, really humble about it. So that's why I really liked her. And she said, you know, I've experienced a really down side of my life. And she said, I just never gave up. And she's been on tour. She's still figuring out what made her fail. She said, even though it's a failure, but she takes it as a lesson. So that's how I view it now as a golfer.
You have also said that Tiger Woods is one of your idols.
Mm-hmm.
You've read his biographies and you've watched him many times mm-hmm. play. What have you picked up in terms of his habits, as well as any inspiration that you've had from him?
His habits, I would say that he's very determined. There's nobody in the world that I think that is as determined as Tiger Woods, which I hope to one day have something as half as he has. But he's very hardworking. He never gives up. He never says no. He was world number one for the longest time. He has won multiple championships in a row. And there's no one like him. But he said every single tournament that he plays, even though he wins, there's something to learn from it. And there's no one like him. So I feel that he's just, you know, someone that everybody has to look up to. Not just for golf. You know, in life, he's not the type to give up.
And he's gone through a lot of ups and downs.
A lot of ups and downs. So.
Now that you've been golfing competitively for about 10 years, how do you think you have changed in the way that you have approached losing a competition?
I have grown these past 10 years. So when I was younger, when I would lose, I would beat myself up for it. I couldn't accept it. I could not accept that someone was better than me, because I would practice so hard and I just couldn't accept that someone maybe worked harder than me. So back then I would cry, I would feel bad that my parents would use up a lot of their money just for me, and I thought I was a disappointment basically. But as I've grown, as I've learned, you know, that not everything's gonna go your way. Nobody's perfect. So right now, when I lose, which definitely there will be a time, I just say that, you know, there's always something to learn from it. Right now, losing to me is, I feel sad, but I don't beat myself up for it. And I understand what I have done wrong.
Mm-hmm. Well, we have a funny story that I remember you shared with me several times, and I want you to share it with my audience.
Mm-hmm.
You told me once that, and I'm not sure how old you were then, but there was a time when your coach took you to a cemetery and left you there for almost about an hour at midnight.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us why he did that, and what that experience was like, and whether you heard or saw anything weird while you were in the cemetery.
Okay. So the image of me being in the cemetery was, I was alone in the middle of a long road, I would say, and I was in the middle of two, because it was a huge graveyard. So I was in the middle of the whole place, you know. There was just different tiers of graveyards. So I was in the middle, and we went at about 12 to 12:30 midnight, and we only finished at about 1:15 a.m. So it wasn't pitch black, but it was still dark, and you know, at the middle of the night, you just feel scared.
How old were you then?
I would say 14.
Wow.
I was 14 years old, because the main reason why my coach brought me there is not just to scare me, but he could see that my emotions when I played were not stable. I would easily get frustrated, I would easily get anxious, get very nervous. So he said that your heartbeat when you're in a cemetery is the same as when you are putting to win a tournament. So your heartbeat beats the same. So he said, if you can learn how to calm down, focus to what you want to do in a graveyard, you can definitely do it in the course. So, but for me, what I learned when I was in the cemetery is that I didn't learn how to fully calm down, but I learned how to block negativity out, block doubt. You know, like when you're in a cemetery, you think, oh, maybe there's someone there, maybe there's something behind you, maybe something will follow you home. But in the golf course, you would think, what if I miss? I would lose, you know? So just to block everything out. Your heart still races, but it's just how you control your emotions. So,
You said there was an incident.
There was an incident where I was swinging the club, and I thought, which I knew my parents were coming up the road to see. My coach showed them where I was standing. I knew they were there. I heard footsteps, and I kind of saw glimpses of their faces. So I said, okay, you know, they're here, I'm safe. And there was a hut nearby, and there was a pillar. And I would always see somebody peeking their head out, you know, and it kind of looked like my dad. So in my heart, I was like, okay, he's there. You know, I'm safe, and it's just him. It's nothing else. So the whole time, my heart was at ease, but I was still, you know, I had a lot of emotions going on. But at the end of the session, I realized there was actually nobody there. Nobody actually came up to see me.
Yeah.
And nobody was standing there, because as I finished, my coach called me to come down to exit the cemetery, and they were all there. And I asked, were you standing at the hut? And they said no. So I didn't think much of it, but I knew I felt something.
Wow.
I felt something.
Wow, that's fantastic. Mm-hmm. So now that you're so far away from home, tell us what you're learning about yourself.
What I'm learning about myself being far away from home is that I am an only child. So even though I don't feel like it, but I'm very dependent. I'm very dependent not only on my parents, but people who are close to me, because I'm always alone. So I've built my strength and my confidence around people. And when you move to a different country that's so far, you don't have that family feeling, you know, maybe after a while, but not at first. So when I first moved there, everybody was really nice to me, but I never felt the connection. But I slowly had to, you know, learn to be alone, to be independent, to do my own things for myself.
Mm.
And, you know, when you're at home, when you're sad, you know, you have people to cheer you up.
Yes.
But there, it's just, you are alone. You know, you have people, but inside, you are the only person that really knows yourself. So I had to learn how to get over my feelings and just make myself, you know, happy, entertain myself, basically. So yeah, that's what I've learned the most, to be very independent.
Wonderful. What are your plans for golf in 2021?
My plans for golf for 2021 is to just focus on collegiate golf when I am back in the States. And if I'm back in Malaysia, depending on the COVID-19, I would play in the professional circuit here in Malaysia, because I am a professional card holder here. So I would want to focus more on the professional level rather than a junior level.
Thank you, Zulaika, for being on the show with me. I know you're busy planning for your return back to the US. You leave in a couple of days, and it's getting ready to storm here as well. I wish you all the best. I've seen you grow and become the fantastic person that you are. And we are hoping in Malaysia that we're going to be reading and hearing a lot more about Zulaika's accomplishments in the coming year. So on that note, Happy New Year, everyone, and see you soon. Bye.